Before we move into the discussion phase, I'm going to take a few minutes to tell you about the work of another person who was supposed to have participated on this panel, and that's Dr. Joseph Matthew. Unfortunately, he had a medical emergency and was hospitalized and was not able to come to this meeting, but I think his perspective is extremely important, and it really rounds out our discussion and our presentations on the challenges of making guideline processes more efficient. So Joseph Matthew is a pediatric pulmonologist at the Advanced Pediatrics Center in Chandigarh, India, and he's a leader of the evidence-based medicine movement there, and he aims to translate research evidence to practice in developing countries, and his perspective is how you enhance effectiveness and efficiency in guideline development in resource-constrained health systems. And he makes the point that traditionally we assume that resource-constrained really just means financial constraints, but it actually encompasses not only money, but material and manpower, and thus resource constraints are applied to settings not just in poor countries, but actually in all societies where one or more components of these three M's may be deficient in the healthcare delivery system. And so some high-income countries may also have pockets of resource constraints, and some low-income countries, conversely, may have pockets with adequate resources for healthcare. And so what does it take to have effective and efficient guideline development, dissemination, and implementation in these resource-limited settings? So he makes the point that there are several challenges, and some of these are common across systems where others are context-specific. So the common themes may include limited capacity among individuals, limited capability of institutions and organizations, a disconnect between academia and policymakers, the absence of an evidence-based practice environment, undue commercial pressures, and of course, financial resource constraints. And then the specific issues could include unique healthcare burdens in some settings related to issues like low literacy or poor empowerment of people, rapidly evolving healthcare challenges such as was faced in Africa with regard to Ebola, and multi-tiered healthcare systems without clear patient access policies. So he believes that the single thing that can most make a difference in such environments is empowerment of healthcare professionals, of healthcare policymakers, and the public. And in terms of guideline development, this would narrow down to empowering healthcare stakeholders to demand guidelines, to develop contextually applicable guidelines that are aligned to available resources within the healthcare system and assure appropriate implementation. And so in India, there are three initiatives that contribute to such empowerment: the No Essentials Program, the Eureka Program, the Signet Capacity Building Program. And he wants to conclude by saying that successful guideline development, dissemination, and implementation in these resource-constrained settings requires us to focus on the local context and work toward solutions that are developed locally, but with expertise contributed globally. And one size definitely does not fit all, and solutions that are transplanted from developed healthcare systems are liable to encounter rejection by the local system in the sense that the gratifying results encountered in the original setting may not be replicated. And he thanks you for your attention. So now I'd like to move toward the discussion, and we'll take questions. Reminder, because this is being recorded, please ask your questions at the microphone and identify yourselves.
Can we hear you? There we go. There's an efficiency issue that I think gin is particularly appropriate to address, and it's the issue of guideline redundancy. The speaker from NICE brought up the issue of the massive portfolio of guidelines done by NICE, and I was hoping the panel as a whole could give their thoughts on societies working across continents, particularly societies based in the US or Canada or the UK or other Western European countries that may have resources and may be doing this already, to collaborate on guideline projects such that some societies are focusing on some areas, others are focusing on others. For example, not having redundancy across USPSTF and NICE guidelines, or ACP and NICE guidelines. So maybe you guys could comment on that. Thanks.
Thank you. Rich Bolarski from Morgan Morgan and Kaiser. Thanks for a great session. Thank you. Answers about operationalizing will apply to this question also. But this meeting has talked a little bit about the opportunities for synergy and increasing the impact of our guidelines by pairing with those writing performance measures and for those working in the implementation space. And so, especially since all three of you work within organized healthcare systems, Japan, VA, NHS, can you comment on whether you've tried to develop efficiencies or synergies across these three spaces and how that may work, not work, be difficult to operationalize, or perhaps present opportunity?
Generally, think there's anything proprietary about this. My own belief is it's time quite ready for prime time. It needs more, again, it's like a self-driving car. I mean, I don't know how many repetitions I can do until I feel good enough about it, but it's more than two or three. And and of course, we do this all basically on the margin, right? So nobody, HRQ, gratefully, and we're very grateful, funded the initial work for this. We've tried to get supplementary funded. It went to Corey, that went nowhere. It went to Atlanta, that went nowhere. And so you know, there's some new place that I think the team's planning to try to send us. But in order to really do this at scale, I mean, you need to make it a funded option. And, but there's nothing we're trying to develop that's required.
Thank you. Question for Dr. Yamaguchi. Are you developing in Japan quality measures from your guidelines?
Clinical spectrum.
But most of this, I think, is actually on the performance measure people, okay? And right now, the performance measures, it's the wild, wild west out there, which is a U.S. euphemism for everybody shoots them up however they want, okay? And there is no, so the guideline community, we have the Iowa report, we can look at the Iowa report, we can look at the gym recommendations, and there's some standards there. There aren't those for performance measures, and they need them. They need an Iowa-like committee to say what is a trustworthy performance measure, okay? And the first item on that, just like that first thing on the Iowa committee for guidelines that's based on the systematic review and there's a transparent process, first item on an Iowa-like committee for performance measures would be it's based on the guideline and here's the transparency about how it relates to the guideline. And if you did that, then maybe people would start coming to the
Okay, if there are no more questions, I'd like